India and Pakistan in a cricket match, if India won the match, they would throw stones at our houses. You know, there are a couple of things in the film which I do not agree with. I'm a closet Sanghi by the day and urban Naxal by the night.
Rahul, slightly difficult question for you.
I love difficult questions. Okay. Bring them on.
My guest today, Rahul Pandita, he needs no introduction. He has written two books. He is a conflict reporter. And most recently, he has written the screenplay for Shikara. So, Rahul, you are someone who is criticized by both left and right, you know, equally harshly. Some people call you an Naxal apologist. Some people call you Modi Bhakt. And now, after writing the story of Shikara, people claim that you have whitewashed the atrocities leveled by Kashmiri Muslims to Kashmiri Pandits, and you are a Kashmiri Pandit yourself. But you are none of that. You are much more nuanced than to be boxed in one category.
Right.
So tell us, how do you deal with all this name calling and so on and so forth?
See, I'm about to change the intro of my Twitter handle. We were joking about it the other day. I said I'll say that, you know, I'm a closet Sanghi by the day and urban Naxal by the night. But on a serious note, I really do not care about these labels. You know, I've done a book with a dear friend of mine called Nilesh Mishra. Mm-hmm. He's a journalist and Bollywood scriptwriter. We've done some remarkable journalism together. He used to say that I prefer a label on my forehead than blinkers on my eyes. So that pretty much sums up the kind of journalism I have done. Long time back when I went to Bastar and I kept on saying, and that is my philosophy in life, I do not believe in the act of balancing at all. Mm-hmm. I only report from ground zero.
Sure.
I have never formulated an opinion on anything from my office in Delhi. Because in my 2 decades of experience, one thing which I've realized is that, you know, when you look at a certain thing, especially in today's world, when there's so much truth, post-truth around us, you go and visit a thing with a preconceived notion. In more than 90% of the cases, when you actually go and see it with your own eyes, observe it on ground zero, the reality is completely different. So that is the philosophy which defines my journalism. So when I went to Bastar, I went to Bastar because I wanted to see things on my own, and I have truthfully reported about this. Now, my book became a hit among a certain political ideology. Sure. But that was just by fluke because, you know, I, as far as I'm concerned, I wrote what I saw. And it is with the same philosophy that I approached my own story, the story of Kashmiri Pandits. And I wrote my memoir, Our Moon Has Blood Clots, with absolute honesty. But, you know, sometimes you also do mistakes. You know, every now and then you also fall into, you know, you see something, it does not turn out to be accurate. At a time like this, you simply apologize and move on. So I say that, I've been a ground reporter for 20 years, and there's not been a single day in the field when I've not learned a new lesson. So that is the philosophy I go out with. Now, as far as this film is concerned, you know, I co-wrote it with Vidhu Vinod Chopra and Abhijat Joshi, who is the writer of films like Three Idiots and Lagero Humona Bhai, etc. So I must clarify here that this is not a documentation of what happened to Kashmiri Pandit. This is a love story, essentially, which is set in the backdrop of the turmoil of Kashmir in 1989-90. But of course, you've seen the film. We have been truthful to what happened to Kashmiri Pandits in 1989. But we have used a certain restraint. That restraint was with a certain consciousness. The restraint was that there's been too much of bitterness in the last 30 years when it comes to Kashmir. Our story has been militarized both ways, by talking too much about it, by being silent about it. So, you know, these are two ways of how the politics has been done on this story. So while I remain unapologetic about, my truth about what happened to Kashmiri Pandits, how the majority community in Kashmir failed them. You know, it's not only about terrorists. It's also about your neighbors, colleagues, friends, etc. But, you know, cinema is a very powerful medium in this country. I mean, you have had films like Rang De Basanti, and suddenly you see hundreds of thousands of youth on the street with those candles, etc. There have been dozens of Gandhian institutions working in this country, and for 70 years, they have not done to the idea of Gandhiji as much as a single film called Lage Raho Munna Bhai did to the idea of Gandhiji. So it is with this consciousness that we approach this film. So the main theme of this film was a love story, of course. And we also wanted this film to start a conversation. But this conversation can definitely begin between ordinary Kashmiris on both sides of the fault line. People who became victims, that is the Kashmiri Pandits, and people who did not do enough in 1990 to stop the mass exodus of Kashmiri Pandits. So, and I think this film has achieved that. We have had reports from places like Jammu where a lot of Kashmiri Muslims are also right now because of winters. And we have had reports from cinema halls where Kashmiri Muslims have gone to see this film. And they have come out crying. Because this film also deals with them with a certain empathy. The idea also was that, see, it's very easy to create the face of a terrorist. You know, we have had terrorists like Bitta Karate, for example, Farooq Ahmadar.
And there has been no conviction.
Who has confessed on national TV that, you know, he was responsible for the killing of more than 20 Kashmiri Pandits. So you get an actor like Mukesh Rishi, for example, you know, who is the quintessential villain of Hindi cinema, and you say, oh, you play Bitta Karate. You know, that's a simplistic way of doing these things. To show blood and gore, you know, it doesn't take much. But if you look at this film, this is a multi-layered film. The multi-layeredness of it is that we have kept the terrorist a faceless terrorist. You may have empathy with someone like Latif Loon, who becomes a militant, who becomes a terrorist in this story. But ultimately, who let you down as a minority community? Your own people around you, people like Haji Saab in this story, right? Who may not have fired a bullet at you, but they did not leave any opportunity to usurp your house. So that was the idea. So the idea is to make the younger generation among Kashmiris, Muslims, who have no idea, who were born after 1990 or who were young when 1990 happened, and they have no experience of, or they have no knowledge of how it was to live in Kashmir.
No, but that is my question for you. The book has more context to it. You know, it starts with the history a little bit. It tells you, you know, how this fight is not, you know, restricted to 1986 or 1990. It has the history. The roots are, you know, really, really old. But so that is why the book sounds more natural and more honest, if I may. In the movie, you know, there is no historical context. And see, right off the bat, I want to tell you that I am not questioning anyone's intent here. You know, it is your story. You survived it. And you can write it in the way you deem fit. But like you mentioned, you know, a lot of India doesn't know about what happened in 1990 with KPs. When you decide to make a movie like that, you can't take a simple route. You can't make a love story out of it because you wanted to start the conversation.
See, this is not a documentary. It's not a documentary.
I'm sure,
Let's make it this clear. It's not a documentary, a series of documentaries, right, which we've done for, say, Discovery Channel or History Channel. It's not even a web series we may have done for Netflix or Hotstar or Amazon. It's a two-hour film.
Right.
Now, all of us have our stories to tell. You know, there have been people whose women folk got raped, people who got killed, people who have survived 19 January, including my own family. So there are hundreds of strands of the story. If we include all those strands in one story, it's not going to be possible in a 2-hour film. The other thing is that it's a mainstream Bollywood film.
Right.
Like my director Vidhu Vinod Chopra keeps on quoting one of international cinema's tallest icons, Ingmar Bergman. You know, he has two rules on how to make cinema. He says, number one, thou shall entertain. And thou shall entertain without selling your soul.
Right.
So the first aim of a commercial mainstream film is to entertain. So for the entertainment sake, you know, you have films like Chapak, which completely tanked. Because beyond a point, you know, people do not want to see certain sad things. So it's a beautiful film revolving around the extraordinary love story of this ordinary couple. And to me, this sums up the whole essence of Kashmiri Pandits as a people. That here were 400,000 people who had to leave their home where their ancestors had lived for thousands of years within weeks of each other,
right?
But one thing which they held on to was dignity,
right.
Was resilience. We did not pick up guns. We did not become terrorists.
You were Gandhis without guns.
Yeah, we were Gandhi. We were the real Gandhi. Gandhis without guns.
Yeah.
So that is something which comes out in this film quite beautifully. So people who have not fallen to propaganda on social media, because you know there are too many lies about this film.
Right.
So you know, I was sifting through Facebook and Twitter recently, and I was shocked to see what kind of untruths are being spoken about this film. Someone said it's a love jihad film. It's a love story between a Kashmiri Muslim and a Kashmiri Hindu. I mean, there's no problem in making a film like this, but you know, this is not what that film is. Someone said that, you know, we've taken money from Mehbooba Mufti, the erstwhile Chief Minister of Jammu and Kashmir, simply because the director thanks a few politicians towards the end of
the story.
That was my
question to you also, if you are thanking Farooq Abdullah, who is in a certain way responsible for what happened in 1990, it sounds slightly convenient.
That's a director's prerogative. They have personal friendships. Vidhu has a personal friendship with Farooq. It's director's prerogative. If the particular person has helped in any way in making this film, like for example, if you look at the acknowledgement of Hello Buster, for example, you know, I also thank Arundhati Roy for giving me, you know, for inputs. Does it mean that I completely agree with Arundhati Roy?
It's not binary in that sense. You know, it's not black and white.
Absolutely. So it's not black and white.
You can agree and disagree.
Absolutely. So it's not black and white at all. So you may disagree with Farooq Abdullah on 100 things. And I'm sure Vidhu disagrees with Farooq Abdullah or Mufti Mehbooba Mufti for that matter. But if as a chief minister of a particular state where it was extremely difficult to shoot a film, especially pertaining to Kashmiri Pandits, especially when everyone knew there that I was associated with this film. There are people who do not like me in Kashmir because of my book. So to give certain help in making of this film, I think it at least deserves an acknowledgement, a thank you in the end. Again, in my book, for example, in Kashmir book, I have thanked many people.
Including Mr. Guha.
Guha is, of course, a dear friend of mine, and he gave me a fellowship for this book. But I was not talking about Mr. Guha. I was talking about people who you can easily categorize as right-wing. You know, I do not agree with their ideology, etc. But they helped me, you know, in pointing out certain cases, pointing out certain stories, which I used in my book. So I have thanked them. Today some of them are dissing this film. That's all part of the game. It's fair enough if they have any criticism about this film. All I'm saying is that if you want to criticize this film, be my guest. It's your right. You know, you spent money, but at least watch this film. And after watching this film, say that, you know, I do not agree with this.
No, to be fair, you know, the protagonist did lose his brother. The wife also lost, you know, her best friend and so on and so forth.
Right.
But it felt to me that, you know, the narrative of the movie was just restricted to the availability of guns.
Right.
You know, it wasn't that, you know, that you lived through it.
Right.
So that becomes a little problematic.
It's a beginning, I would say. It's a beginning. I mean, hundreds of films have been made on the Jewish Holocaust. And the most stark of it, Schindler's List, you know, you must be hearing about it in this film's context, for example. You know, many people have come to me and say, oh, this should have been the Schindler's List of Kashmiri Pandits. But I don't know whether they know it or not. When Schindler's List came out, Steven Spielberg's, I mean, many people liked it. But many conservative Jews rubbished that film.
Right.
I think I saw that film in the college, and it's one of the starkest films about a certain genocide which I have ever seen. I've not been able to see that film again. But there are many ways of looking at it. And like I said, it's a beginning. So there's a Schindler's List. There's also Life is Beautiful, where you do not see even one killing. So all I'm saying is this is not the end of it, that one director has made a film and then nobody else can. People who feel strongly about it, filmmakers who feel strongly about it, should make more films.
Right.
And maybe some of things which we may have missed in the story should come out in other films. I mean, there cannot be one film on Jewish Holocaust.
So now, you know, coming to your book, you know, one incident which really struck me was when your father was watching the India World Cup and India won in 2011.
Right.
And then you were taken back to, you know, India West Indies match in Kashmir,
right.
And then,
right.
You know, there's a precursor to that.
Right.
So tell us, for our audience, tell us, you know, what happened when India played against West Indies in Kashmir.
See, it's not about that particular cricket match. As my book mentions, there was a big communal riot in Anantnag in South Kashmir. Where scores of Kashmiri Pandit houses were burned, the temples were razed to ground, women folk, you know, a lot of damage was done. And we have grown up with this feeling as if we are, you know, we are a religious minority. And for us, the idea of India remains sacrosanct. So, for example, if there's a Al-Aqsa, you know, there's some incident in Al-Aqsa Mosque in Jerusalem. The target victims became Kashmiri Pandits. When India and Pakistan, in a cricket match, if India won the match, they would throw stones at our houses. And then, you know, the idea of 15th August, Independence Day. So they would order a blackout, and if we kept our lights on at house, so somebody would...
Why would you not retaliate?
Throw a stone. It's not easy to retaliate as a religious. You're less than 5%. So it's very easy for an outsider to say, okay, why didn't you retaliate? But when you're a religious minority, when you're less than 5% of population, it's your basic idea is to survive on a day-to-day basis. Especially when there is turbulence, you know, when there's a riot, or if the lock at the Ram Janmabhoomi is opened up in Ayodhya. So we have to face the brunt of all the events happening around us. You know, when something happened, you know, you become like a submarine and then hope for things to pass off. And when they do eventually, when 1990 happened, we're hoping that, you know, this is again a continuation in the same process, you know, that it will last for a couple of weeks and then everything will become all right. But sadly, as you know, it didn't, and we are still in exile after 30 years.
The other emotional bit I was talking about was, you know, your mother's story about 22 rooms. And my grandfather came after, you know, partition. So 1990 is a certain way, you know, close to what partition was back then. So I'm vaguely, you know, in the know of how refugee life happens. But tell us about, you know, the story, and then how did it impact you so bad?
I think it was a very difficult time for all of us. And when we left Kashmir, nobody had a clue about the actual magnitude of what had happened. Remember, this is the time when there was no social media, there's no Facebook, there's no WhatsApp, there's no mobile phone. Even the landline density in Kashmir is minimum. So we have absolutely no idea. There's no media. You know, Doordarshan is as closeted as possible. You hear an occasional report sometime on the BBC, radio service, Urdu service. And that is your only window to what is happening outside your immediate neighborhood. But it is only after we left and we reached Jammu in the beginning of 1990s that when the actual magnitude of what had happened to us became clear to us. So in those days, in the chaos of those days, we did not realize the magnitude of it. You know, what had happened in South Kashmir, what had happened in Northern Kashmir. Brothers could not tell their brothers that they had left. Colleagues could not tell their colleagues they had left. It was in this chaos that, you know, we tried to rebuild our life. And in those days, you must have seen that shot in the film also. We used that shot in the film also.
That tomatoes?
There was a professor I used to know who said when we came to Jammu, he said, Parliament mein bahut shor machega.
Right.
Hazaron panditon ko ghar se begar kar diya gaya. Dekhna Parliament mein kitna shor machega.
So we're hoping that, you know, the Hindu India, as we understood it, will come to our rescue. You know, there will be rallies in Boat Club, and there will be, you know, a lot of protests will happen in Parliament, and, you know, politicians will rise and talk about us. But as we know, nothing happened. So the story kept on being relegated to the margins. Even the media went, because the main story was happening in unfolding in Kashmir, so all of them went to Kashmir. And you know, I sometimes see the archives of 90s. You know, there's an occasional, you know, some junior reporter has been sent to a refugee camp in Mumbai or Delhi or Jammu, and you know, they've done a feature story, but nothing about the magnitude of it and what has befallen us and why has it befallen us. There's absolutely, you know, very, very minimal reporting in those days. And it is during that time when we started rebuilding our life. It was extremely difficult. For example, when my family left, we left on 4th April 1990.
Why did you decide to stick around for 4-5 months? You were hoping again, so?
Yeah, so all of us left when a personal tragedy struck us quite close by. Because, you know, in your most mundane human heart, you think tragedy is something which always happens to others. It will happen far away from you. So it is with this hope that we survived there for a few months. It will go all right. It will go all right. The army will take care of it. The Indian state will take care of it. You know, these are just a handful of men who have got these arms, and they got the support of in those days, a handful. Yes, you know, when people went to get arms training in 87, 88, it was just a handful. But after that, a floodgates was opened. Thousands of people came and went on their own accord. But in the days when the Intelligence Bureau was sending reports to the Rajiv Gandhi government that, you know, this is happening, it was basically a handful. And but none of it, you know, no help came to us. And, you know, I remember my family having slept on newspaper sheets for weeks. And of course, the worst affected in a family are the women, right? Because, you know, they have to take care of home and hearth. And I sometimes wonder about it, because my mother was roughly my age. I mean, exactly my age when Exodus happened. And I sometimes think, if I lose everything today, what will I do? I won't be able to cope with it. So you have a responsibility, you have a family, my parents, for example, and thousands of other parents. It's not only a story of my parents or my family. You lose everything, and you do not know where your next meal is going to come from. How will you enable the education of your kids? Where will you live? So it became quite a traumatic experience for all of us, and I think it left an indelible mark on us. So that trauma has passed us, because we are almost 100% literate community, and we made sure that we rise up. If you read my book, my father tells you that you don't need to worry about where our next meal is going to come from, but we'll get you admitted in a school. And my sister was in college at that point of time, and we held on to that belief. Was it difficult? Of course it was extremely difficult, because we had absolutely nothing. But gradually, you know, we picked up pieces of our lives and moved on. But that initial trauma of a few years, it doesn't leave you. It scars you for life.
So where, you know, in life are you? I'm sure you have forgotten, or at least forgiven. But do you want to go back to that driver and tell him that, you know, who told you, die, Pandit, die? And you said, do you want to go back and tell him that you survived?
He was a man who was pushing a wheelbarrow on the Srinagar Jammu National Highway as my family was escaping a taxi. And I think the taxi had stopped because an army convoy was coming from the other side. And he looked at us, and in a very menacing, semi-sexual gesture, you know, very brutal gesture, he raised his fist like that and he said, "Die, Pandits, die." And of course, I said this in the screening here in Delhi also, that I don't know where that man is, but if I know where he is, I would like to go to him and say that, look, not only did we survive, but we also excelled in our lives. Today, we do not have a homeland, but we are spread from Jammu to Johannesburg, everywhere. It's a 100% success story. But unfortunately, many people are not a part of this success story today, because the generation which faced the brunt, my parent generation, many of them are not with us today. And that's why I say, you know, the official count of Kashmiri Pandit killings in the 90s is 700. But if you really ask me, the number of people who died was in tens of thousands. Because in the initial first years, thousands of people died of depression, snake bites, scorpion bites, sunstroke. they are not ordinary, they're not natural deaths, they are murders as far as I'm concerned.
So Rahul, I also have one slightly difficult question for you.
I love difficult questions. Yeah. Bring them on.
So you know, I have read many write-ups by you, I've seen your interviews also, and you don't look like someone who is here to sort of conform. You know, your resignation letter to, for example, the Hindu is an example of that. But when you decide to write about Yasin Malik's dreamy affair, you know, it doesn't sound right. Why make a human out of it? You know, it just doesn't sound right.
That should tell you everything about the kind of journalism I practice. That here's a man who lost everything because of people like Yasin Malik. But he can keep that bitterness out of the story for a moment. Because for a journalist who is really a journalist, no bitterness should come in the way of his retelling of stories. But it's not only about Yasin Malik. I don't know whether you followed my earlier work. I've reported extensively from Kashmir from 98 onwards. I have reported extensively about human rights violations in Kashmir. I've reported about Afswa, for example. That has only been possible because I consider my journalism sacrosanct. When you do journalism, you keep your personal history aside. You keep your personal bitterness aside. If today Bitter Karate grants me, I've met him, by the way.
Okay.
Someday I'm going to write about it.
Okay.
But that's for another...
But how was the experience?
That's another book, perhaps. But you go there as a journalist and you keep it out. I met all separatist leaders. I've gone to Mr. Sayyid Ali Shah Gilani's house also, where he has caught hold of my hand and said that he has gifted me a few books on Islam and said that you must read about this because Islam is not a religion for us, it's a way of life, etc. But you have to do these things. You meet all kinds of people in journalism. You meet murderers, you meet assassins, you meet... this is what I've learned from my mentor of sorts, V.S. Naipaul. You write cold surgical prose about some things, but you see a lot of things with empathy.
Mm-hmm.
That empathy is not for a terrorist, but you know, there's a cold surgical precision with which you report certain things. That is what I have practiced all my life in journalism, and if I get a chance tomorrow, I'll do the same.
But why would you even talk about his wife? Who is interested? Why?
There are people interested. Look at how many hits that
story has gone.
Yeah, yeah. People are interested in. It's a profile. It's a profile when he married a woman who nobody knew about.
Mm-hmm.
Who is this woman? Who is married to an Islamist now, but back in Pakistan, paints semi-nude paintings, pictures. She's a successful person, educated person. Why would she marry a semi-literate or almost illiterate person like Yasin Malik?
Mm-hmm.
So there's a story behind it. What moves me as a journalist is to tell these stories.
Mm-hmm.
Like I said, if I get a chance tomorrow about telling the story of Bitter Karate, what is his other life, I'll go and say it.
But is it simple to sort of remove your personal experience?
It comes by training.
Mm-hmm.
It comes by journalistic training. When that is important for you as a journalist. Otherwise, for example, how will I report from Kashmir?
Right.
I cannot report from Kashmir.
Right.
If I land at Srinagar airport and just think of my identity as a Kashmiri Pandit,
right,
then I'm sorry, I won't be able to function in Kashmir. I have met all kinds of people in Kashmir. I have been to houses of Lashkar-e-Toyba militants who were terrorists who were killed in big police encounters just 2 months back.
Mm-hmm.
After I've left that house, I've gone to the house of the police officer who killed that person. So it's all a part of the game. In Naxal areas, for example, you know, you meet police officers, you meet Naxals. I've been
mm-hmm.
embedded with Maoist guerrillas for a long time.
Mm-hmm.
But you do, because you're a journalist, and you should never say no to meeting people or listening to their part
right.
of stories. I've traveled with all of them. So that comes by training. And
right.
if you're not able to do that as a journalist, then I don't think you should become a journalist.
Let's talk about, you know, what's happening in India right now. And I'm talking specifically about the Azadi slogans, which
mm-hmm.
you hear in JNU and so on and so forth.
Right.
And for you, these Azadi slogans are not, you know, you cannot take them lightly.
Right.
And a lot of young Indians don't even know what were these slogans which KPs were subjected to.
Right.
So tell us a little bit about that, and then what is your take on the Azadi which everyone is seeking in India these days?
No, I wrote an article about it. So I'm saying this, that I'm not here to lecture young Indians on how they should fight for the idea of India. They are most welcome to go to Shaheen Bagh and assemble there. They are most welcome to go to Azad Maidan and fight about their idea of India. It is a free democratic country. Sure. They should do it. If they feel strongly about it, they should do it by non-violent means. This country has a space, you know, every democracy has a space for such protests. So they're most welcome to do it. But when they say, when they use Azadi slogans, I just want to remind them, like I have in the past, that these slogans were used in the brutalization of a particular community many, many years ago. That is how these slogans began in the first place. Now, if you're saying that you are using these slogans for women empowerment or to fight against communalism, that is your choice. But my duty is to remind you on how these slogans were used in the first place. And what happens to 400,000 people when they hear it on Twitter, on Facebook, on TV channels, being ringing every now and then. My simple idea about JNU was that as a university, you should have an open mind about everything. If you want to, I mean, you are most entitled to your politics, left or right, I have no worry. If you want to debate about whether Afzal Guru got a fair deal in this country or not, you're most welcome to do it. If you want to debate about whether Kashmir should remain a part of India or not, in a classroom or a seminar, or if you want to make a poster about it, it's absolutely all right. But the moment you say, Bharat tere tukde honge, inshallah, inshallah, it is not acceptable right to me. I'll raise my voice against right you. Yes.
So, but you did have a platform, right? I mean, you had a movie to talk about and you decided not to put all these slogans. Was that
but this
a
is, this is not a... Slogans are there. We've seen...
But not film. All these slogans.
Not all these.
Yeah.
Not all these slogans. Some of them have been used. Some of them we have left for future films.
Okay.
Because hum hi sab istemal karenge to baaki log kya karenge?
But baaki log fir se banayenge, you know?
Baaki log banana chahiye. Baaki log banana chahiye.
But was it a choice that you didn't want to...
It's a two-hour film. We chose some.
A slogan would have just taken half a minute.
So, you say that. Now, this gentleman will come here and say, oh, you have not included the story of Naveen Sapru. Some gentleman will come.
I'm sure.
You know, there are multiple reasons.
But weren't slogans, very important?
When you start working on a creation, right? If I'm writing a piece, now I always listen to a couple of people who are my mentors, for example. You know, when I'm writing a book, I'll take the advice of Ram, for example, Ram Guha, right? When I'm writing a book, I'll take the advice of Pratap Bhanu Mehta. You know, they are my friend, they are my mentors in some ways. I take their advice seriously. And if they ask me to change certain things, I'll take their advice. But if I leave my book or my work to open to scrutiny, where anyone can come give me advice,
right,
then it becomes a mess.
Right.
Because ultimately, it is my vision. It is my vision of how things unfolded in a certain way. Now, others are most welcome to visualize
right,
it in a way. We put everything in the story which we thought was important.
Right.
Every layer, every visual which we talked about in this story has been thought about time and again. I must also tell you that, you know, there are a couple of things in the film which I do not agree with. But it's ultimately the director's vision. And when you work with the director, when you worked with a film director, especially for a person like me who has absolutely no experience in filmmaking, it's not journalism, right? So you also respect his vision, and then you put his writing, put your own writing to fit that vision. That's his vision. He's most welcome.
Can I tell you what I didn't agree with the movie?
Sure.
I didn't like the part where, you know, Latif was called by Indian Army. I thought that was pretty dramatic and really uncalled for.
But it happens all the time.
The terrorist, the army decides to call the friend of a terrorist.
It happens. It happens all the time in
right.
Kashmir.
Okay. I thought that was pretty...
Everything is influenced by real life.
Okay.
Everything is influenced by real life.
I take your word for that.
Do you see police encounters happening as recently as 2 months ago?
Mm-hmm.
Where a terrorist is stuck in a building somewhere in South Kashmir and his parents are called to encourage him to come out, to surrender.
It happens. That bit I get.
Yes. Even now, people are called from outside to help in interrogation of terrorists all the time.
But there was no interrogation in that scene.
Well, they wanted him to interrogate, but he died. That's what we show in the film.
Okay. So my final question to you is, Rahul, why is Kashmir still the home? You lost so much there. Why can't you make a home in Delhi, Jammu, Johannesburg, like you said?
Kashmir is home because that is where my heart is. Our heart is, mm-hmm. or rather. We may live anywhere. Mm-hmm. But Kashmir will remain our home because our culture, our gods, our way of life is there.